Everybody, thank you. Welcome to stARTup Art Fair's panel, Art Fairs, What Are They Good For? I first want to thank everybody for coming. This is great to come out on a Sunday. I know we have wine and water, and that is a bit of an incentive. I want to thank Matt Gleason of Coagula Curatorial for offering his space. Matt's also on our selection committee for stARTup Art Fair. I want to thank all of our panelists for coming, Max Presneill, Catherine Ruane, Nathaly Charria, and Matt again. And I'm just going to have them introduce themselves one by one. And then I'll be shooting questions at them. And people in the audience here, in the live audience, if you have a question, raise your hand and we'll try to incorporate it to the conversation. And people online who are watching this through Facebook Live, also you can write in questions and I'll try to keep track of them on my iPad here and incorporate them into the conversation. So welcome everybody who's live and welcome everybody who's on the interwebs. So let's start with Matt introducing himself.
Hi, I'm Matt.
how do you call yourself?
Oh, if you don't know who I am, you're not in the art world. I don't know.
Okay. If you gotta look them up, then there's a problem.
Google me.
I'm Nathaly Charria, I'm an independent curator and art consultant.
And I'm Catherine Ruane, and I'm an artist.
I'm Max Presneill, and I'm an artist and a curator. I run the Torrance Art Museum and a couple of other things.
There you go. My name is Max Presneill, and I'm a curator and an artist. I run the Torrance Art Museum as well as a couple of other organizations.
And he does a very cool event called the Mass Attack, which is awesome, where artists get together for one night and do these large art events. And there's one coming up?
Saturday,
November 12th. And it's at Torrance Art Museum, correct? Good. All right. So my name is Ray Beldner. I am the co-director and co-founder of the stARTup Art Fair, which is an independent art fair for, contemporary art fair for independent artists. And it was co-founded with my collaborator, Steve Zapatero, who used to own a gallery in San Francisco with his wife, Heather Marks. And I am a longtime Bay Area artist and teacher and entrepreneur, I guess. We decided to put together this panel because we get asked a lot of questions from independent artists about the value of art fairs. Why should I do your art fair or any other art fair as an independent artist? And I think, one, I'd like to talk about what an art fair is, how it functions for galleries, how it functions for artists, what are the benefits of it, what are the potential pitfalls of it. And so that's kind of the conversations I'm going to be directing to the people we have on our panel today. And I'm going to throw them out, and I'm going to let you guys, you know, whoever feels comfortable answering it, but, well, maybe you all want to answer this question, but let's just talk about what is the role of art fairs? How do art fairs function in the art world?
Make money.
To make money, yes.
Well.
Wait, who makes the money though?
Well, if they do their job well, everyone. but if they, essentially it's for the gallery. It's a place to bring curators to you. And hopefully, certainly collectors and buyers, knowing there's a separation between collectors and buyers, that can bring a one-stop shopping.
Right. So it's uniquely different from just having a brick-and-mortar space and opening up like we are today and have people come in off the street and buy stuff.
The thing about an art fair is it's not an aesthetic installation, and it's not a, if you sell a painting in the first 10 minutes of the art fair, the first thing that happens is that's off the wall and something else is up there to be sold. And so people, I've had people tell me, oh, go see my piece at Basel, and you go and it's gone because it's sold.
Right.
And so, you want to, the real goal is for the collector and the gallery to meet up. I want collectors to come to my gallery for a variety of reasons. They do not make it to my gallery. Based on geography, based on traffic, but at an art fair, it's kind of a level playing field. You know, I could have a booth in a fair and a big name gallery, a bigger name than me could be there, and a gallery that's just starting out that doesn't have my track record could be there. And the collector will walk down and...
It's all equal to them.
One would think. I mean, yeah. they Oh, that's my damn phone. Sorry.
It is live on Facebook.
Live on Facebook with Elvis Presley. Oh no, now it's copyrighted. Everything just fell out. I don't even know who that is.
I might remind our audience to turn off your phone.
another phone. Okay, we'll turn that one off too. But yeah, like, people are definitely going to go to that fair because the big name galleries are there.
Yeah.
And but we're going to benefit as much as, like, in Culver City. Blum and Poe opened in Culver City in 2002. All of a sudden, Culver City real estate went up because many galleries wanted to be near Blum and Poe. It's the same thing with an art fair. The people that are going to come for an art fair for Hauserworth and Schimmel, I want to be in that art fair.
Right.
You know, I want those people to see the artists that I represent.
So an art fair is primarily a commercial venture where dealers and artists can get their work in front of a much larger audience. And that audience is brought in through your own efforts and through the efforts of even bigger entities. So that collectively kind of it works to, I guess, you know, the rising tide raises all boats.
Yeah, I mean, it's a platform.
Yeah.
You know, it's a platform and it's a market space. And it opens up and expands your network. So people who want to go to art fairs want to go to art fairs. And that, I think, is what's so helpful about it. It's like, whether you're a collector or a dealer or a curator or another artist, or you're curious to see what kind of work is being made right now, you know, if you're at an art fair, it's because you want to be there. And then, you know, alongside that, fairs put a lot of effort into their PR and their marketing. Mm-hmm. So then you meet, you know, you're able to meet journalists or other writers who can continue to build these conversations and relationships.
I think too that as an artist, you're trying to have people see you, you're trying to have eyes, and let's say I want Max to see my work, but when I call Max up, I can never get a hold of him, or he's never there, or it's just not...
I have that same problem with Max.
I'm using him as an example, and that, you know, and yet here you are at an art fair, and then here comes Max through the room, so you have this parade of people, and your art fair was really good at that. You brought a circulation of people, which, you know, is like a set of eyes that you can't, haven't been able to get attached to, because you call up galleries and say, hi, I'm an artist, and I'd like to, and then you get a click, right?
Yeah.
So this was a wonderful opportunity to be able to just stand there and watch this parade walk through, and I thought, yeah, this is working.
You know, you need to think about this in statistical terms, really. The fact is that most galleries, any space, anywhere in the world, is only going to get a minute percentage of traffic, actual traffic, walking through the doors, even with really big collectors.
Right.
They're only going to go to certain cities, they're only going to go to certain galleries, time constraints, et cetera, who they know, how they know things are about. The art fair's really opened it up so that there's... These people know what's going on, they know that this is where they should be, they come from all over the world, they see all the spaces they've never heard of, they see the gallery, which is normally presenting multiple artists, so all those times that they did go to see Blum & Poe, they might well have only seen one artist at, and this time they might see four or five. They get to socialize and be seen to be socializing, so there's an added benefit to their credentials as art people in some ways. I mean, it has all these things that totally suit the collector.
Yeah.
It totally suits the gallerist for all the reasons that Max said, because you get all the, you get everybody else's traffic.
Yeah, it's like, I had one collector really interested in this artist for like a year. The artist had a show here, the collector never came. Yeah. 3 months later, the art advisor, hey, we're in downtown, we're coming to see his work. He had literally, the show had closed, 2 months had gone by, and I'm like, yeah, come get the work. So I had, oh my God, I only have two pieces. So when he came in, I said, look, I only have two pieces left. So I said, are you going to this fair? What fairs are you going to? And I'm asking him, because then if he says, oh, I always go to this fair, I always go to that fair, that's the fair I'm gonna do.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like a, you know, like what fair is the collector's going to?
Right.
The best way to find out is to ask the collector.
Yeah. So from my perspective as a working artist, I've noticed that if you're not an artist who's connected to a gallery, you don't get to be in a fair. And that's part of the whole reason why we started Startup Art Fair. We wanted the artists to be able to tap directly into that world, right? So, because we're talking about art fairs, gallery art fairs, and there's a kind of a different, there is a very big difference between a gallery art fair and then an independent artist fair. But my understanding is, from the gallery perspective, is that most of the business now is being done at fairs.
Well, look at it this way. I haven't done a fair in about a year. I did a fair in April. Mm-hmm. And like the year before that, I did 3 fairs. And the year before that, I did 4 fairs. But what I did is I picked up collectors at these fairs. So yeah. I now have people that I can directly market to.
Right.
And I like the fair did their job. I don't need the fair anymore.
Right.
I have somebody that I can market to directly and have done so successfully. This is a person I would have never met. Who would have, these people, most of these collectors have never been to LA. If they come to LA, oh, we were in LA, but we didn't make it to your place. I mean, you know, it's a big city. I did a fair in New York, and it's like, you know, frankly, if you have the choice of going to this fair or like Gagosian Gallery and the Chelsea Galleries, why would you go to this fair? So, I mean, you know, I'm honest. So,
yeah.
You know, I mean, it's an honest perspective, not trying to think like you have to. So, but like the fair did their job.
And
now, am I coasting? You know, should I not be pursuing other collectors? Well, I'll be back at that same fair that I do every year, is the Dallas Art Fair in April, which I had great success at, and they definitely introduced me to a lot of good collectors.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like the gallery owners that I know, if they don't do fairs at least on a semi-regular basis, they lose business. There may be, you know, an initial flush of interest in sales around a particular fair, but if you stop doing fairs completely, wouldn't that be kind of death to the business?
Yeah, I mean, you can see an attrition too. Like you have, let's say you've made 20 sales, you've sold to 20 individuals at fairs over a 3-year period, and then you've resold to X number of them, and then 2 years later you've resold to XX number of them. So the attrition is going to happen. So it is, the way to do it is, do more art fairs, meet newer people,
The problem is that people aren't walking into the gallery spaces because they might not be finding them. And the big money's always with the auction houses now because of the deals that are made on percentages and resale and guarantees, etc. So all the really high-end stuff is being taken up by that kind of thing, by the big art fairs, etc. Now, the bigger question is what do the smaller galleries do, and how do they go into it? Because it costs a lot of money to do an art fair.
Yeah.
And, people lose everything on them.
Yeah.
So how do you integrate into that? How do you choose which fairs are right for you as a gallery? And more importantly for this discussion is, for an artist, is how do you either get into that system one way or another, or how do you take advantage of the system that you provide?
Yeah.
But also, isn't it a long game where you do one art fair and you may not have great sales the first time out, but you start to build a familiarity that then builds at the next art fair. In other words, you become a reliable source of, you know, the kind of art that you make. You get known for.
There's fair worlds, there's reputations for things like Chicago, in Spain. There's several fairs that are kind of well known. You have to go back multiple times before the collectors kind of trust you.
So the question that we've had from this gentleman is really about like who comes to the fairs. Turn this down.
To your fair.
To our Startup Art Fair, which is an artist fair.
Right.
And that's a really good question. So, and I wanted to turn our focus a little bit to an artist fair, because, and I want to hear what Catherine has to say, because she actually was a participant in our first LA Startup Fair. So my goal in creating this fair with Steve was to have a platform where artists can go directly to the public, to the curators and museum directors and critics and buyers and collectors of their work. And for the same reason that galleries do it, is that it's a marketing effort that you do to get into the right fair, to reach the right people, so you can advance your career through sales and through exhibitions and museums and other places. So, and what Steve and I do once we have our artists selected for the fair is we spend an enormous amount of time marketing the fair to collectors, to dealers, and to art consultants, and we bring in lots of critics, and we have lots of tours of different people. And so our first time in LA was, I thought, for being the first time in LA, and we're not originally from here, we had dozens of gallery owners. And I'm not just talking small gallery owners with, you know, little spaces in funky neighborhoods, but, you know, people like Jean Malone from Cirrus Gallery and Mark Moore Gallery, and people of that caliber and everything in between. So we had, I would say, dozens of gallery people. We had, you know, also probably dozens of art consultants come in. And people made sales, artists aren't always forthcoming about how much they sell or what they sell.
Neither are galleries.
Neither are galleries. So you kind of have to be, you have to extrapolate from what they say. Like, especially galleries, they'll be like, we did great, which means they probably barely broke even, right? But artists are, they're honest when they don't sell anything. They'd be like, I didn't do well at all. And when they do well, you know, it's a hard conversation to ask somebody to tell you hard numbers, right? But I know that Catherine did well, she'll probably tell you that. I know that some people didn't do that well, and people did everywhere in between, right? And it could be like from selling a couple thousand dollars worth of work to maybe $20,000 worth of work.
What was the hard numbers?
It was 10,000.
Yeah, yeah. So, and that's awesome, but not everybody does that. What I always say, you know, from the perspective of as a fair organizer, is that you have to think about the art fair not just as an opportunity to sell work, but as a way to connect to your community. And I think that's the way dealers think about it, that it's actually a marketing tool that connects them to the larger art world that you can't get walking into your gallery.
It certainly worked for me when I started my gallery to do a lot of art fairs, to be seen as, wow, that gallery's happening. They did this fair, they did that fair, that was, of all the things I did, doing a lot of fairs was good, and I would assume that it's good for an artist based at least on the quality of the fair. If you're doing a reputable fair, like the StarTup Art Fair, I think that the worst case scenario is you're going to spend money on brand extension, on people knowing your name and associating your name with your art, and maybe remembering your face. And then, you know, from there you develop networking relationships. So you can look at it as expensive networking, but I don't know that it's even overpriced networking in this day and age where everybody, there's just a glut of self-promotion out there.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's like definitely an investment on yourself as an artist and seeing it as, you know, prior to selling the work, seeing it as, like I said, like a platform to share your work and to promote yourself. You know, there's a lot of PR that goes with being in a fair, a lot of marketing and the network that you meet. So if you don't sell work at the fair, that's not to say that, you know, you don't get a show with a different curator down the road, or that, you know, when someone's thinking about, you know, it was, last year I met Stephen Whistler, who I thought had a really fantastic exhibition.
Yeah.
He did a fantastic job of like really transforming the space. And you know, that's just turned into a great relationship with ongoing conversations. We haven't worked on a project together yet, but I know that at some point down the road, we will be working on something together.
Yeah.
It's really important to understand how to search for the right opportunities for you as an artist. Because when we're talking about the kind of fairs, there are some really crappy fairs out there.
Yes.
And the best way of testing the water, as it were, is to look at their selection committees.
Yep.
Look who, like, I mean, you guys have got some really good people on board. You've got Dan Cameron, some major curators involved.
Yep.
And it's important to look at those kind of issues to say, this is an organization that's clued in.
Yeah.
They understand who they need to bring in, whether you do or not, it's a different discussion.
Yeah.
But at least you understand who's needed, what kind of people need to be brought in. You understand the community which you're aiming at. And a lot of those fairs don't. And it's really important to differentiate and say, well, I'm going to make my pick for that amount of money you do have, because it's expensive.
Yeah.
where's it going to go, and it goes into the right place. And if it goes into the right place, that is bringing those...
Then it's money well spent.
Exactly, but yeah. Like you're saying, I know that the museum's shown a couple of people in the past that we picked up at StartUp, and I know that we've picked up a lot of people over the years from art fairs in general.
Yeah. No, I mean, it was important for me and Steve. I mean, I know there always has been, and there are beginning to be more artist fairs for artists. And a lot of them, in my opinion, are pay to play. So anyone who's got, you know, a check can get in. And so that means that the quality is all over the place. You might see some interesting people there. You might see a lot of horrible stuff. And we tried very hard when we were coming up with this concept to make sure that it was juried and it wasn't us, so that we didn't have any vested interest in who got in, that we left it up to the professionals, and that the jurors were, you know, people in the art world who I would like to have my own artwork, you know, in front of. Because we figured for the money that it costs, and it costs, you know, it can cost anywhere from $2,500 to up to $5,000 or $6,000 for a room or half of a room or whatever. So for that money, we want to make sure that you know you're going to be in a good place, promoted well, with a good, you know, cohort of other artists. And not all the art fairs are like that. You do have to be very careful.
I've been in vetted art fairs, and I've been in free-for-all art fairs, and it's, not only is it noticeable, like if a collector sees you, the first reaction of theirs is like, oh good, you're like a good gallery, and, you know, pat myself on the back here or whatever, but then they kind of go, what are you doing here? Like, you're a better gallery than this fair, you know? And you're kind of like, yeah, this wasn't as good a fair as I thought it was going to be. And so, you know, and there's a million reasons why you want to end up at a fair, you know? Do you want to go to Miami and be in, like, the worst fair in Miami? Is that better than being in no fair in Miami?
Right.
You know, what I found out is it's better to not be in the bad fairs in Miami and just go and hang out and then, you know, walk into people's booths. Hey, you got a good booth, and then leave.
Yeah.
That's my job as a gallerist. As an artist, though, you know, what are there 10,000 galleries? There's 200,000 artists.
Right.
So it's the numbers game for an artist. I think it behooves you to be finding any opportunity to show. And I always tell artists to budget, you know?
Yeah.
You know, if you have no money, like if an artist has $1,000 a year to spend on their career outside of art materials, then, like, you know, spend $100, 10% on postcards,
right,
just to get those postcards, and spend some money on a website, right?
Right.
That's okay. Yeah. Well, now if your annual budget is $20,000, okay. Well, now you know.
Consider doing
fair. So if you do this fair and you use the money for some other PR purposes, your career is going to accelerate proportionately.
Yeah.
You know, there's a problem here that I think is really, really important. I don't know if anybody else does, but I do. It's, you said, yeah, some fairs can be seen as pay to play.
Yeah.
All fairs, in one sense or another, are pay to play.
Yes.
Now, it's whether you're willing to invest in your own career or not.
Right.
Now, is it in some way, it costs everyone money to do it, even if you're the artist and you're going to the gallery.
Right. It still costs.
Everything costs in one way or another.
Yes.
And
who's paying for it?
Yeah. It's who's paying for it, and what's your return? If you do one way, you're investing the money yourself, but you take everything back.
Yeah.
As about the gallery's taking 50% off of you.
Right.
Straight away.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's money being paid even if you sell well.
That's right.
So I think it's really important, and because I feel slightly that the idea of pay to play is a term, I do get it, like, oh, vanity gallery. Well,
yeah.
Vanity gallery is also you investing in yourself.
That's right.
And the term,
I guess, pay to play is a kind of a generic term that basically means no matter how crappy my work is, I can give you a check and
it
be in
that. What it does is it sorts this idea that if you're any good, then you don't look after your own career, you don't invest in your own career, because somebody else will come along and discover you and do it for you.
Right.
And that's a really,
that's
a way that makes sure artists remain in a position where they are always subservient to gallerists.
Right. Totally.
And that's not in their benefit.
One day the fairy gallery godmother is going to swing her wand and get you a solo show.
Yes.
And then everything will change.
You know, and I know people who are, they've waited 40 years for that visit from that fairy gallery godmother, and damn it, she still hasn't shown up. You
right.
know?
And even if she does turn up and she gives you the solo show, nothing actually changes.
I've had galleries in LA, I've had representation in New York, I've had representation in San Francisco. And just because I've been in a gallery and had those relationships, that doesn't mean that that's the panacea for all my problems as an artist. And what I learned after a while is that I couldn't just sit back and expect my dealer to take care of everything. Because really, even a relationship with a gallery is a partnership, and you have to bring to the table as much as they bring to the table. But a lot of artists think that once I get into the gallery, it's all set. But really, in general, what I believe is artists have to take control of their careers. They have to invest their own money and their own time and their own energy. As shitty as that is, and as time consuming as that is, it's just part of the business. Well, if you're not willing to do that, you don't get back any return.
And artists need to understand that they are a business.
Yeah.
They are the sole proprietor of manufacturing, marketing, and consuming the sale.
Yeah.
And you know, the thing about the pay to play, when I, doing the first startup, as I walked around looking at other artists, in my mind, the pay to play meant as long as you could pay for the money, you were in. And it was really, in my case, it was really reassuring to walk around and look at every space and realize these people have been selected. They're not just people who paid and they can show up. These are people who paid the money and were chosen out of a group. We'll take that one, that one, that one. And I was proud to show with those people.
Maybe there's a better terminology. There's pay to play means anybody can get in, but pay to be vetted might be a better, like a jury show is, when you see a jury show,
the fact that it was juried.
Somebody juried it and their name's on it. Like, I like all this art, you know, and that's...
Well, in fairs, galleries, a lot of those big art fairs make enormous sums of money from all the people they turn down.
Right,
because
that's true.
There's art, 60 galleries that get in and there's 450 that didn't.
Art dazzles.
So they stop to pay
and they pay $300 just to apply.
It's $450 to apply to any of the three Basel fairs. So it's $450 for Basel Hong Kong, for Basel Switzerland, and for Miami, Art Miami
you
Basel.
You can spend thousands just applying as a gallery to these fairs.
Yeah, and I
hey, we're only $25.
Hey!
I thought I'd put that plug in.
But like, I think that the fees to get in are, it's kind of inconsequential relative to once you're in some of the fairs, especially like the secondary fairs, tend to have a lot of funny charges for funny things. Oh, I need an extra light. You know, things like that.
$500.
Yeah. Well, what I learned is it's cheaper to bribe the Teamster to put up five lights than to buy one light from the fair. So you learn fast.
Yeah. So Catherine, tell me why you did StartUp. I'm kind of curious. What was your thinking on it?
Well, when I first heard about StartUp, I said, well, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to pay that money.
Because you had all the received opinion over the years saying, artists should never do that.
Yeah. Well, and yeah, but you know, I'm old enough now to realize that if you act like a child, then you'll be treated like a child, and that you do have to take responsibility. And I did actually talk it over with Matt, and he said, you know, you do this show, you're getting eyes. And I thought, well, I'm not going to get any eyes in my studio in San Diego that nobody would drive out to anyway. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I have to go to the mountain because the mountain's not coming to me.
Yeah.
And so I, you know, threw in, you know, my wish list, and luckily was accepted to show.
Yeah.
What I didn't know was, you know, I had to figure out all the lighting, you know, and those kinds of things. Now I have it down pat.
Yeah.
And I can light in a hotel room, into a gallery, like you wouldn't believe.
Now that's an art.
Yeah.
Good.
There is a particular art to showing your work in a fair, but particularly in a hotel fair, because I don't know if you guys went to StartUp or have been to a hotel fair, but generally you can't hang anything on the wall with a nail. So you have to use nailless hooks like those 3M command strips. You only have the ambient lighting, so maybe you have light from a window and you have a couple of lamps. So you have to figure out how to light your work so it doesn't look all dark and dingy. And then you might even want to clear out the room and you have to figure out where to go with the furniture without taking it out of the room. And so artists become incredibly creative.
Right.
Like we have big walk-in closets in the hotel that we do in San Francisco, and some artists will just take everything in the room and shove it into the closet.
That's what we did.
It's a completely empty room. Yeah, it's amazing, but then it's kind of scary, like where everything goes. And then other people come up with really creative ways to kind of hang lights without actually screwing them into the wall or the ceiling. So you could like use poles that are like pressure, you know, whatever, and then put clip lights on. So you really do have to be very creative about how you set up this exhibition, because it's only a 3-day thing and it has to come down and the room has to look exactly the same as when you left.
And it's good to know the height of the ceiling.
Yeah.
Because if you have work that's too tall, you know, there's only so many ways you can put something in 8 feet. And that's 8 feet.
You got to fit it in the door.
That's right. That's
the diagonal. Yeah. Measure that diagonal. Because,
Yeah, we've had that problem with LA. It was people brought work that couldn't fit through the door of the hotel.
Yeah, so, surprise.
Yes.
You know, years ago, the Chateau Marmont had a...
They had a great fair. I did that fair.
And then in 1995 or 6.
Yeah.
And the art, you know, the LA art scene was still pretty small there. And, you know, you just had, you know, you had small... You know, people had Warhol prints on the bed. Just laying on the bed. I didn't know where to put it. It's not framed there. You know, so it's there's an art to it.
Yeah, it's a little more intimate than a booth fair, I think.
I know, I've met collectors who actually pine for something different. Yeah. When they've gone to this art fair with the white wall and the hallway and the convention center, or, you know, they've been to this fair, and I did a fair called Aqua in Miami, and it was in a motel, and they actually took the furniture out for you, yeah. God bless them. And, I just remember I saw some pretty big international collectors, and they would say, oh, we always come to Aqua. It's not even the best fair, but it's just to get out of just those hallways with that same lighting. You know?
Yeah.
So just that little pizzazz goes a long way with people once they've kind of been jaded to a certain thing. Much like a style of painting will be in fashion for X number of years, and then just, I'm sick of looking at that stuff. I want to look at something new.
It's the atmosphere as well, because I used to go to Aqua every year.
Yeah.
We'd go to the big fair, go and see some of the ones, but we always went to Aqua because it had an atmosphere. And
exactly.
Because it was a bunch of people doing it for themselves, a bit more energetic, the parties were a bit more relaxed, and less spotty, like, oh, you know, who am I talking to?
The models in the jacuzzi maybe helped, yeah. It's like, those three models have been in that jacuzzi a long time.
Wow.
Her skin was all pruny, like, oh, I've been too long.
But everybody that came through, well, not everybody, but a good percentage said they liked an intimate, they felt that it was more intimate to come into these little rooms.
Yeah.
And, you know, the artist is right there and available. And, you know, you whipped out, Annie had her best 15-year-old scotch.
Oh, that didn't hurt. I went to Annie's room, she had a nice scotch, it was good.
And it's also really great to see what everybody does with the you know, like you have an opportunity to like stand out and show who you are as an artist. You know, how do you transform this room into your space? Like last year there was Kathy Aoki did a really beautiful exhibition, and she did, I was like, how did you do
the Gwen Stefani Memorial
piece? You know, we're living in a very corporate era in the art world, and intimacy like this, you cannot understate that enough. You cannot overstate it enough that it is really like, it can be the make or break thing that turns a collector on. And one collector can change your whole career. Nam June Paik said his entire success was dependent on having gone to two parties and just people he met. He could trace back to the people he met at two parties.
Two parties.
Every great opportunity he had, he remembers from those two parties.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the art world.
Well, and definitely the way that Steve and I always talk about fairs in general, but art fair too, is that it's like a ripple effect, right? So you show in San Francisco or LA or Chicago, one of our Chicago fairs, and some few things happen, but then that kind of expands out over time, and other opportunities happen, you know, over months and maybe even years. And that's what makes them kind of interesting events to participate in. I want to open the questions up to our audience, if you guys have any questions, and our live audience too. I see people have commented on our live stream. It's mostly about the sound. They're like, no sound! But I think we finally have sound. If we don't have sound, I want the people watching live to please tell me. But does anybody here in the room want to ask a couple questions? Yeah.
Let's say I get chosen.
Yes.
And then I'm going to share my room with another artist. Do I get to meet that artist, or am I in contact with that artist before, so you can plan the lighting before?
Okay, so the question is, in case people online didn't hear it, so the question is, if you apply to StarTup Art Fair in LA, and you do a split suite, this is something we do only in LA, we don't do it in San Francisco or Chicago, but you can apply just to have half of a room, because the rooms are so big, we will pair you with another artist. If you're local in LA, we'll pair you with an out-of-town artist. That way the out-of-town person could take the bedroom and sleep there, and then maybe you don't have to. And then we try to curate as well as we can those pairings, because you don't know the person we're going to pair you with. We try to connect you up ahead of time. And I have to say, some of the pairings we did, they weren't all perfect love connections, but many of them, people really became good buddies from that experience. And a lot of people thought that they had applied together as a group because the work seemed so nicely curated. So, but you would get a chance if you applied to LA, certainly, to meet the person you're going to be paired with if you decide to go with a split suite. Did you like, you liked your partner?
We had a good time.
Yeah.
And we were a good match, I think, aesthetically.
Yeah.
So we looked, I thought we looked really good together.
Yeah, and the scotch. There was the scotch.
And there was the scotch, which really said, it's definite.
But it would be really useful is to put together like a cheat sheet for artists that got in saying, here's some of the things that other artists have found useful in terms of making the right environment to walk into. Because if you try the hard sell, you're really going to turn people off. If you sit there on your laptop while somebody's looking around and ignore them, you've lost ground.
Yes.
If you're not asking people who they are, then you're potentially letting things go past you. Having alcohol in there
definitely helps.
Keeps people in there if nothing else.
That's right.
And then you get a conversation.
So the more that we do this fair, the more that we get better at coaching the artists. And we do, I'm glad you brought this up, Max, but we do send out emails within, you know, weeks and days before the fair to remind artists, make sure you have a mailing list, sign-in sheet, make sure you have all your collateral. It could just be nice cards or some kind of postcard or brochure. Make sure that you light the thing well, that you have someone help you, that you don't just sit there in your room when the fair is actually happening. If you're tired, don't just close your door. Keep it open. Have someone sit in the room for you. Go have some lunch. Come back. Make sure you engage everybody. You get out of a fair exactly what you put in. If you just sit there, like a lot of galleries do this too, and maybe they're too cool and they don't need to actually approach people. You'll see galleries at fairs, they're on their laptop, they're not even looking at you, they don't give a shit.
I was in a fair and the guy assured me, he's done so many fairs, that the buyers are only here at the VIP opening on Thursday, and a few come in on Friday. He goes, Saturday and Sunday, they're just the townies. Don't bother. Yeah. This is Miami. I'm like, And we sold nothing, and he was not there on Sunday, and when we sold like a ton on the Sunday. Yeah. So everything that he said wouldn't happen, he wasn't even there that it maybe would have happened to him, but it happened to us.
You can't fall into that trap. You don't know who a collector is. One of the biggest collectors in the Bay Area for years was this guy, Rene DeRosa. He looked like a farmer. He always had overalls on and a baseball cap, and everybody used to not give a shit about him or say anything to him, but he used to buy, you know, very deeply invest in artists in their careers. And so you never know who's going to buy something. So you have to engage everybody who comes in.
There's an old saying in sales where on high-end sales is you look at their shoes. Because their shoes are supposed to be like, they have nice shoes, that's somebody with money. And then you'll see people like this, and they won't get off their ass until they see that nice, the Prada handbag or the really nice shoes. And there's that collector, Peter Norton. I'm not sure if he's still really buying a lot, but he, whenever I would see him at art fairs, he would have had the dirtiest feet up. It was like, but you'd see him at Mocha, you know, you'd see him at a museum where he's a trustee at the fancy dinner party. He had the best pair of shoes in the room. You know, he was a billionaire walking around. But at the art fair, I still remember distinctly, would always have this beat up pair. And he had the same pair of shoes. The two times I saw him at the art fair, he had the same beat up pair. Like, that's his art fair shoes. If they're not going to hassle me with these on, they don't get my money.
Some of the really big collectors deliberately do that. They'll go and stain t-shirts and pair of shorts.
Yeah.
I've seen that a lot.
They probably don't want to be like glad handed.
But everybody knows who they are. Yeah, paying attention knows who they are.
Oh, they want to be asked.
Some may not. You don't know. I don't know. I got a question online. I'm going to ask this question for her. Can you talk a bit about price point and how to decide what size or price point to include in your room? I don't want to undersell myself and only bring $50 pieces, but is it realistic to think I can sell a $10,000 piece?
Wow. You know,
what do you think?
That's a big gap.
I think it's a gamble. I think one of the things is, and I think it's a fair question to you, Ray, what would you say is the income of the average household, or not even the average, let's say there's a top 10% that are coming to the fair that are really the buyers, okay? Yeah. 1 out of 10 people who are coming to your fair are the buyers. What is the household income of that top 10%?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't know. I know that this is what I know in general of the average fair goer, their household income is in six figures.
Okay.
That doesn't necessarily mean they're buyers. That just means that's the people that are coming, at least to the San Francisco fair. Because it's a fairly affluent crowd in general who goes to art fairs. Uh-huh. And San Francisco is a fairly affluent place. And if you don't make six figures, you don't live there, really. If you don't make over $100,000.
In my experience, this is only from working for a big commercial gallery one time.
Yeah.
And as an artist, and as going, running my own spaces. And
yeah.
I think what, and this is different for, depending on the fair, but what we found was, big collectors buy big. It takes as long to sell a bit, you know, to sell, yes, a big piece as a small piece.
Right.
But the you know, what you get back is so much more.
Yeah.
So trying to sell lots of $50 things, you might cover costs. You sell one reasonably sized piece,
right,
you've covered everything at a,
yeah,
profit. And you're more likely to network into the more serious collector with more serious work.
Right.
And that tends to be scale-wise.
Yeah, would you rather as an artist sell a few $50, like people going like a lot of these things, and this is where the, like art, where artists buying booths gets a bad reputation, is because artists are so desperate to have any sale, they don't see the bigger picture,
yeah,
and they go in with like, oh, this is a greeting card version, and I have mugs with my painting on it, and that's when it's like, oh boy, this is,
yeah,
terrible. So I used to run the brewery. I was the president of the board at the brewery art, mm-hmm, colony, and we had an open brewery. You know, you're already paying rent at the brewery studios. You could consider that your fair fee. And you'd see these people with, where they could go make mugs with their paintings on it.
Right.
And then somebody would just have one or two big abstract paintings. And why did that guy make the sale? And it's like, yeah, that's the perfect way to put it, Max.
Yeah.
It takes, if you got to sit there and talk 20 minutes to somebody to sell them a $50 coffee mug, or $20 t-shirt or something, why not spend the same 20 minutes and sell a $10,000 painting? But in answer to that question though, it's always gonna be a gamble.
Well, and my advice always to artists is to bring a range of work, right? So you don't necessarily have to put it all up, but you definitely want big, higher priced pieces. There are at least a couple. So those big collectors that come in and they see a few modest pieces go, what else do? And you can go, well, here. Right? Or people who see the big stuff and they love it, but maybe their means are a little bit less. Even people who make six figures, that doesn't mean they're going to spend, you know, over $5,000 for a piece. So they may want to see things that are multiples or, you know, smaller or secondary things. I don't believe in the mug t-shirt thing, but I do think you should have probably a range of stuff that is pretty modest for a few hundred up to whatever your top is. I think it's, if you can fit it in your room.
Any gallery will tell you this. You put up the spectacle in the space,
yeah,
and then you sell half of it on the small stuff on the back,
yeah,
that people will say, well, yeah, what else, because...
Yeah, they want something in better price points.
And because people, you know, this is a marketing ploy that some people use, and, yeah, it's a successful one. Because people like flicking through thinking, oh, I picked this one, I found this one.
Yes, I found it.
Yeah,
yes.
But smart galleries will go and layer those, you know, they'll have maybe a little showroom at the back if they have enough space. And then they'll just have some of them leaning against the wall and put, you know, three or four of them.
Yeah.
So people will do that.
Yeah.
Well, people,
that's, yeah, where the bed comes in handy at an art fair, right? Because you can put up your nice show and then you can have works on paper on your bed. So people go, oh, I can't afford $5,000 for that painting, what else? And then they could go through the,
yeah, pick. Don't waste money on the framing, because invariably people, when they take stuff back, reframe.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you spend too much money on framing your work, you're wasting your money.
Yeah, there's
good to know.
There's a lot of, like, for example, if you do Art Basel, you know, there's conventions for dentists, and there's convention for art framers, and there's conventions for every, you know, skill set. There is every thing that you could work at. There is but there's no convention for billionaires. And Art Basel Miami posits itself as the convention for billionaires. So I was on the phone, I had an artist named Karen Finley, who's a pretty big name artist, all things considered. She's kind of part of art history. And I was getting interviewed by the art newspaper in Miami when I was at a fair called Miami Project. And Karen Finley was performing in our booth. And they're like, wow, they're gonna write an article about this. And we got a lot of press for her. And the guy who runs the fair, Max Fishko, said to me, I think you got more press for our fair than our publicist got for us, having Karen Finley here. And everything was exciting. And I'm getting interviewed by the art newspaper. And, you know, answered a few questions. And she said, well, how much are these paintings she was doing? And she was doing live performance paintings that involved a person, a collector. And I said, I think I said $900, and they hung up on me. Like, it wasn't a story anymore.
Yes.
Like, something for $900? Because they're writing about art at Art Basel.
Right.
That billionaires buy.
She needed to have $100,000
$90,000! And then we would have had a line of billionaires.
You should have had the $100,000 bomb.
Yeah, see, where was
that? Where is
that? It was a bit of like, that kind of like, artists have come to me with that whole price point issue, and I've said like, okay, they want to do giclées. They want to make a big painting that they charge $100,000 for, and then they want to do giclées. Mm-hmm. And I say, you know, if you notice people with money, they don't want to buy things that other people can buy.
Right.
They want to buy something unique. That's the attraction of art, in that it's that unique artist, you know, that brand. So I'm always saying, you know, put some zeros on it.
Yeah.
It's really hard because like developing a price point, I think you need to be realistic, okay? You need to actually work around similar kind of level of artists. What, who you show with, where have you shown, what kind of track record, how often are you selling new work, who's it going to?
Yeah.
And those kind of things. But the biggest mistake I see in artists with this is they start thinking, well, I'm going to be here rather than here, so I'm going to jack my prices up.
Yeah.
And, or I'm going to, or maybe I sold this one piece, so now I jack my prices up. Every time you should really think about a thing that you don't price your work through the works you like best.
Right.
It has nothing to do with anybody else liking anything best.
Right.
So have a system.
Yeah.
There are other systems out there. And I use one as a painter, I use a system. You gradually increase those prices according to sales, etc. But start yourself low, because if you start high, you can't go back.
That's right.
So start low.
Well, there is only one market for your work. I mean, you are part of the market. Every artist is part of this larger art market. And it is based on your experience, it's based on the number of sales you have. Yes, you can't price things higher because they either took more time or you like them more. You just can't. There's just this.
Nothing to do with it.
So I do have to interject that asking artists to be reasonable. Nice. I've had artists who had high, you know, well, if a Basquiat sells for that much, you didn't die of a heroin overdose, dude.
Well, anyone who goes to do a fair and doesn't know how to price their work, I think what they really need to do is talk to an art professional like you, and just say, here's what I've done. I've sold a few things at this price. Help me. Because you don't want to overprice yourself. Then nobody will buy it. And you don't want to underprice it, because then you're going to look like a total amateur as well. And that is a very tricky thing with younger, emerging artists.
You know, most collectors, most buyers, anybody who's been to the rodeo before, they know to haggle.
Yeah.
So when you underprice your work and all of a sudden if somebody's really interested and they offer you less, you know, the ego of the artist is of course devastated and insulted. So I do think, yeah, there is a certain realism there.
And then you get the person who's the art consultant, who says they're going to place the work in some project, bum, poop, nowhere, and they want a discount.
Yeah.
Because they're not the end buyer.
Right.
And so they, you know, the question is, what can you do for me? You know, this is, I think the theory or the suggestion is, I will do a lot of work with you from here on out.
Yeah.
And so there you are in LA Art Fair, and you have to make these decisions.
Well, then there's the collector who is wise enough to know that those discounts are usually priced in with the assumption that they're coming, and so they know that you've got a 20% discount already priced in, so they ask for a 40% discount. So there's a whole culture in the art world that's difficult for somebody doing like one fair one time.
Yeah.
But I think an artist who is in the startup art fair is the kind of artist who has a commitment to their career, who's guiding their own career, and they might be doing the startup art fair five times.
Yeah.
You know, they might be working their way through the system. So to think that you're gonna learn it all, know it all, and do it best the first time, tell me about the first painting you ever made as an undergrad.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, was it, as good as the art you're making. Don't say it was better, but but you know, but
it's true. You learn. I mean, you learn the business of art as well as the making of the art over time. You get better at it. And if you do a fair, you probably know from your first experience with stARTup, you learned a lot, I would assume.
Well, and I, you know, was just lucky enough to be on my toes at that moment. And yeah. I said, well, actually, you know, in these stARTup art fairs, the artist is already priced their work at a lower 20% discount. So what you're getting is the best price you can get.
But I think as an artist, you should also be pricing your work with the 15-20% built in, because your most collectors are
will ask you to take it off,
ask you for a discount, and it's okay.
There's different negotiating. I mean, yeah. I went to one fair and I just said, here's our gallery policy is we don't discount. I can't discount for you because I've not discounted for so many other people, so many bigger collectors than you. So there's this kind of like ego thing, like, well, I'm a big collector. Oh, okay, I guess I have to pay full price. So there's a lot of ways to do it, but you have to, I mean, just, you know, you'll learn a game plan that works for you.
Well, and the thing is that it's not, you're negotiating with people and they're asking, you know, they want to buy it and they show interest and then, you know, they ask for a price. You're not at war. People. I mean,
right.
they want it, so you're trying to kind of move back and forth in a dance. You know, I'm thinking, oh, I spent all this money to be here, and now I have to discount it, and, you know, I just didn't want to do it.
You just have to have a policy. You have to have a plan. It's either you come in with the idea that you're pricing it a little bit higher because you know people are going to discount it, or you have a no discount policy, which plenty of artists do. They say, I'm not discounting at all. You're already getting it at a great price. Or you decide, I can do only 10%, that's it. I'll give you 10% for anyone, that's it, bam. And then, you know, go from there. But yeah, if you, and be consistent about it. But there's a lot of ways to attack that problem.
Well, if you've got it planned in that you know you're gonna go 10, 15, 20% yeah. depending, you should be doing, if it's possible to do the kind of homework, and know who might be there, or listen, because somebody says such and such is wandering around.
Yeah.
If that person approaches you, then you shift. Shift what you're going to be able to do, because you're going to be smart about it, because you want that thing placed with that collector, perhaps.
In the end, you have to decide, is the discount more important or less important than the person who's going to buy it?
But you need to keep in mind, if you're selling at a fair like yours, if you did it at a regular gallery, they take 50% off already.
Right.
So if you go down 20%, then it's like, well, I'm still making more money than I would have.
Yeah, because the price is the price. I mean, you know, if you have a $10,000 painting and I put it on my wall, it's still $10,000. You only get $5,000, but I found you the buyer. So the art fair, you put money up front to be in this art fair. That's kind of like the money the gallery would have taken. The goal is to sell enough to get past that, so you are making that percentage.
But you've got to keep those prices consistent. It's really important to understand that if you're showing with galleries, you're showing wherever you're showing.
Okay,
if you do this, you keep those prices.
You've told artists that they have to be reasonable and consistent?
Oh, I
mean, we're talking about artists here.
I'm an optimist.
We're talking about artists here, so.
Don't be afraid to sell. Don't be afraid to, like, keep it moving. You know, you're going to make more work, and you need to make more work.
Yeah.
And the reason why you're here is to sell it.
So know that
there's a very strong likelihood that you're going to be asked for a discount, and that's a part of the culture. And, you know, what's 20% here and the piece being placed at a home, that you're going to be able to work on more work. That's the point of it, is to continue making
right.
work.
Yeah,
so, you know, it's like, right.
Yeah.
So it's like, don't be afraid to sell the work, and don't get, you know, insulted if somebody asks for a discount.
Just
have a conversation about it, but, you know, think about, if you're not in LA, then you have to ship the work back. So a lot of the time, it's better to just place it in good homes and build those relationships, because those collectors are likely going to keep buying from you.
One of the values of being a gallerist for the artist is the artist never has to have the conversations that I have, where if they had it, their ego would have just been mutilated. So I can take all the purchases, go, it's okay, it's that piece is okay, you know. So I think with the stARTup art fair, I do appreciate your advice that you're gonna make more work. Why not get this work, you know. I think people have the short-term view is, I paid this much to be in the stARTup art fair, I should make this much money back, as opposed to, hey, I'm rocking and rolling. I sold a few pieces, I spent some money, I'm promoting myself, I made some connections, I networked. I mean, there's a lot going on. you know, to fixate on the sale might be a...
They come away from a fair thinking of success if they had the cards of 10 good collectibles.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Totally.
Yeah, but I'd rather say, okay, if I go to an art fair and you're saying, like, you have 10 people that you met that are museum trustee level collectors that want information on your artist, or you had one sale that you almost broke even on to a designer that it's going to a house where they don't even care, which would you take?
Take the 10.
You know, they print money every day, but they don't print business cards like that every day.
Let's stop for 1 second. Quick question. We have a question in our live audience, so let's...
Is your fair photography friendly?
My fair is incredibly photography friendly. It's like a typical art fair, gallery or artist fair. We have artists that work in photography, video, performance art, painting, drawing, printmaking, digital media, pretty much any kind of media that's out there. Sculpture.
My roommate was a photographer, and I draw, so we were. I mean, we did have, you know, an affinity, but she was definitely a photographer, and people who looked at drawings looked at photographs too, and purchased both.
Yeah. You know, it's not a fair. It's less to do with whether the fair is photo friendly, and it's more with how well the fair does its job of its PR campaign hitting the range of collectors needed. Because photography is a separate collecting body often.
That's right.
So, that's job at that end.
Like, are we like looking for those buyers of photographs? Absolutely. And we get a fair number of dealers coming in who are specifically, that's their specialty. We sell a lot of photographs because I know that our artists sell a lot of photographs because the price points are generally tend to be a little bit more friendly, and there's multiples as well. So they do well. You had a question.
So related to that, what is the maximum, placement or openings in the hotel?
How many rooms are available for artists in our fair?
And then what is the number of submissions? And then you try to balance the different media also?
So we have about 40-something rooms available, or is it 30-something rooms available? Last year we had 43 or something paying artists in a certain number of rooms. And then we worked with a few nonprofit art organizations that brought in a bunch of other artists. They get their rooms pro bono, free, and they program them however they want. I think we can, because we also split our rooms in LA, we could probably accommodate like up to 50 artists.
How many submissions you had last year, for example?
In LA or in general?
In LA.
I can't tell you off the top of my head. I don't know. I know in San Francisco our submissions were somewhere between 80 and 100 people, something like that.
Always too many?
Not enough ever, really. Yeah. I mean, my goal is that we have hundreds of artists applying so that the jury has the total pick of the cream of the crop. It's not that we don't have the cream of the crop, we have amazing artists that are, but it would be really nice if we could take, like in here in LA, we don't take the whole hotel, we take like 3/4 of it. I'd like to take the whole hotel. I'd like to have that many artists.
You'd rather have, you have 43, you want 43 good artists, not 40 artists and three, they're okay artists who can afford it.
Yeah.
Okay.
We want to have, you know, artists that are just like, that have to compete against a lot of talented competition.
Do they rent out the Janis Joplin?
We were going to take it last year, but we decided to make the fair a little smaller. But if we took the whole hotel, that would be part of our... People don't know the Highland Gardens Hotel is known for being a place where a lot of rock musicians stay and actors. And Janis Joplin famously died there, OD'd in one of the rooms. But not the room that we use for our fair. It's another part of the hotel. You had a question.
Yeah, I was just wondering, how it is now, for the San Francisco fair, do you mostly have people from the Bay Area applying, whereas in LA, it's mostly people from LA, or is there something?
It has... So, as we do more, what we are finding is that we get about a third of the artists that are accepted come from the region. About a third are previous exhibitors that are coming back, and about a third are from all over the place. And I mean China, England, Africa, you know, Miami, Louisiana, New York, Chicago, all over the place. So, yeah. And I hope as we become more well known and more popular, that we'll have more international artists come. But it's a bit of a, obviously a, an investment if you're coming from outside the area, even if you're coming even from outside the state, how do you ship your work, drive it over, whatever. So, yeah, that's a good question.
She comes home, like, free room.
Well, that's the nice thing about the hotel fair. The other reason why we did the hotel fair is that people can stay in their room, you know, so you save about $1,000 on lodging cost if you come from out of town. So it makes it a little bit more affordable. I'm gonna ask this question. This is a question that came online. It says, if sales are not the only goal of exhibiting at a fair, can you talk a bit more about what else artists should be focusing on during the fair? Should they be trying to collect as many emails as possible, talking about the upcoming events, asking leading questions? I don't know, I'm gonna throw it out to our artists.
I think that, I didn't realize this was gonna happen, but I got people who said, I'm really interested in your work, here's my card, stay in touch.
Yeah.
And so you kind of, you're building a network without even, I guess, prepared to do it. The other thing is that with your seminars that you ran, mm-hmm. That kept a continuous cycle of curators, gallerists, and writers that came through all the rooms.
Yeah.
And so I'm meeting people that I've been reading for a long time and never was able to put a name to a face. And so I think if anything, you're building a network is what it gets down to.
Right.
And it's like Matt said, you're gonna get, I think, you know, it was right on, you're gonna get eyes. You're gonna get eyes you don't even know about.
Right. Yeah.
So.
And you never know, yeah, oh, I didn't make a sale, but a museum curator liked one of my artists. And he ended up with a solo show at the museum, and then the museum bought some art. So I was like, oh, hey, it worked. I finally made money off that one fair that we didn't have any sales from. Because the museum curator, who came in and gave the guy the show, we didn't make any money off that until the museum bought stuff. And all of a sudden, hey, I made money 2 years later.
Yeah.
So, you know, these things happen.
At the museum, but I do know that we picked up a number of artists from fairs, like I said earlier, but we've taken people from stARTup.
Yeah.
Bijan Yashar was on last show.
Photographer.
That just came out.
Yeah.
And we picked him up from your fair.
Yeah.
And we've worked with him twice now, and I know that stuff
wonderful.
Has come from that.
I mean, another stARTup success story.
Well, no, all these things, you build it up. None of us have been doing this long enough that you know.
Catherine made a good point, though. The other thing about our fair is that, and for the people in the audience who may not know, is we run a series of panel discussions at the fair, 3 on Saturday and 3 on Sunday, and Nathaly has taken part in those. And, you know, and you've obviously organized them and been on them. And they bring in more people, more art people from the art world who go around and also become part of the fair. And they're enormously popular. And we started recently videotaping. It's the reason why we're doing the Facebook Live feed today. It's like, I'm thinking now, instead of videotaping, and we'll, if we can get over the technical issues, we'll Facebook Live them and then they can be on our Facebook page. And maybe we'll videotape them as well. But they bring in a whole other group of people, publishers, critics, we had a critic roundtable, curators, and you did a great thing on professional practices. You did one on women in publishing, right?
Yeah,
it was, they're amazing, and they're incredible resources, and they're free, right? You get in the fair, whatever, you pay $15 to get in the fair, $20, and then you go to this incredible series
of conversations. And you could also do, like, with Annie, because I shared with Annie Seaton, we would split, for instance, if there was a, of all the seminars that are coming up, I go, oh God, I really would like to come sit there and hear that. And so we trade off, and so I would go to like the one you had, and then she says, well, I want to go to this other, so that we always had somebody in our room, but we also got the benefit of being in some of the seminars, which was invaluable.
Yeah. Well, I'm not gonna belabor the conversation too much longer. We did say this is from 1 to 3, and I know we got off on a late start and a little bit of a rocky start, but if there's a couple more questions.
I'd like to request that each of you introduce yourself with your last names, because although you know each other, the audience, us and some of those that are online, don't know who you are.
That is a great idea. Okay,
and for the,
and this is
a,
and this is really important, especially for the people looking online, because I think the first part of this conversation was without sound. So My name is Ray Beldner, and I am the co-director and co-founder of the Startup Art Fair. And the Startup Art Fair is a contemporary art fair for independent artists, and we do it in San Francisco, LA, and Chicago, and it's coming up in LA in January, at the end of January, and the deadline to apply is November 10th.
My name is Paul Schimmel, and oh, no, 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 just kidding. My name is Matt Gleason, and I do a lot of things in the art world.
My name is Nathaly Charria, and I'm an independent curator and art resident.
My name is Catherine Ruane, and I am an artist, and I did the first LA startup.
And I'm Max Presneill, and I'm an artist and curator for the Torrance Art Museum and for Ultra Curatorial.
Great. And you'll be able to review this conversation online again, and it'll be on our Facebook page. Do we have any other questions from our audience, live or online, before we go? I apologize for all the technical issues and the sound problem. We had thought we were gonna, you know, be able to have better sound, whatever. We're learning it as we go. I just wanna say again, thank you all for listening and coming. Please look at startupartfair.com. Our deadline's on November 10th, and if you don't want to do the LA Fair, we're gonna have a deadline in February for San Francisco. And if you don't apply as an artist, please come and enjoy it. It's gonna be a lot of fun. It's at the Highland Gardens Hotel in Hollywood, January 27th through 29th. It's the same time as the
Los Angeles Contemporary.
Yeah. And she's gonna be part of it, and he's gonna be part of it, and he's gonna be part of it. They're all involved. We're all involved. So, love to see you there. Matt, we're signing off.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. You